No, no problem to tempt me for that.
You're easy.
Yeah, just okay. You know.
You come a bit of a way to talk to us today.
Yes.
Small trip. Yeah. Is there a direct flight to Tel Aviv to LA?
Yeah, small trip with a little motel, Four Seasons, on the road.
You're not used to the Four Seasons as part of your production setup?
That's a very, very high budget film, Fill the Void. You know, we're used to that.
Yeah, well, I assume you had a trailer. Everybody had their own trailer. You don't even know what they are, much less that you're having one.
Oh, I get it. Like in the on
like a little
set,
caravan.
I had a chair with my name on it and lights. And
well, that's nice. Yeah. Did they just come around you with towels when you wanted to change, or did you do costuming?
Grapefruit and grapes.
Yeah. It's craft service. So craft services were. That's what we call them here. Top of the line, filet mignon and lobster every night. Or I guess there would be no lobster.
You name it.
It'd be bad to have trafe as part of your craft services. You have to watch out for that. So it's a tiny budget movie?
Fill the Void, yeah.
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 But in Israel, it's considered to be like a high budget movie, isn't it? Really?
Really? No, that's not a high budget. I would say the average budget in Israel would be $1 million. That was a lot less.
Oh, okay.
She would have written a check, had she known.
I thought
she
it
would
was
help
a big
out.
Production, yeah.
No,
I thought,
no.
Wow.
So how do you raise money for Israeli films?
We have a film fund that if you're lucky, you get money. Oh, we got pretty nice amount. And then TV was in, and another fund, Bet Avichai, and we managed with that.
So do you budget to kind of what you can get? Is that kind of the other way around?
I do that. I don't know if everyone does that. I think people will try to raise more. And I say, let's go with what we have. You know?
Because you are a guerrilla filmmaker at heart, or because you, that's just your mindset about making things?
Because you know what's important.
Mm-hmm.
And what's not, then you just give it away. You know?
So do you think the film is better for having less money?
No. No, it's not a question of better or worse. This is it, and just work with it, you know, and not, and just know what's important, you know. And if it's not, then don't, you know, hang out to it because it was written and because you dreamed about it. It's not important. You know, give it away.
So, how did you take your first step on this particular road?
Like,
what for this film?
Okay.
Did the idea come to you, or did you start writing? The birds come out of the skies.
I heard once David Lynch saying, like, that he feels like a fisherman, and he said that there's a lot of fish in the sea, and he's like picking up the ideas of. It was really funny. I never thought I would make films, definitely not this kind of film, not big film. It's been 20 years since I finished film school, didn't have the urge, and. The idea came way before the film was written. Didn't think it was a film. And the idea was, you know, I met a beautiful young girl at a wedding, and she was just engaged to her late sister's husband. Mm. And that like blew me away, and I started researching it. Didn't think about a film at that time. And at the end of that research, I met about 17 girls, some of them are already grandmothers that were married to their late sister's husband.
Hmm.
And at the end of that, I said, maybe there's a film here.
So it's not quite as shocking culturally as maybe audiences think it is?
No, it's not. And when I researched it, then at the end of that research, I wasn't even sure that there's a drama there.
Hmm.
Because it was so natural. It looked so natural to just fall in love and marry your late sister's husband.
Hmm. And how do you fit into that universe?
Of what?
Of Orthodoxy.
Okay, I became religious 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I was not religious.
So you weren't raised that way?
No, not at all. Far away. So that's a choice I made. And I'm really them. I belong to them.
So is it? Does it seem normal to you? Does it seem to make sense to you? Something like this?
Not at the beginning, because it blows your mind how you make a transition like this in the family. How does a mother see her other daughter being with her other late daughter's husband? I couldn't understand that, but when you start, you know, researching it and talking to women, so natural. So, like everything, I'm always blown away at the beginning, and then I don't understand what's the big deal at the end. So
how did you get involved? Did you just audition, or did you have a connection or something?
I auditioned. I auditioned. Yes, that's what I did.
Because you're finicky, or why did she have to audition so many times?
Yeah.
Because I was sure she's the one, but because I was not experienced and she was not experienced, everyone around me that were very experienced said, check it out again, check it again. It's all about her. It's all on her shoulders. She should really, it's a complicated character. See that you can bring all the sides out and then to match it with someone and here. And for me, I knew that it was her. It's just, we wanted to make sure that she can handle the whole film on her shoulders, and she did.
And what is your relationship to Orthodoxy?
Rama, right now. Before that, I didn't know anybody. It was all new to me. I mean, I know that you see people walking in the streets, it's in our country, but you don't really know anyone in person, because our lives doesn't get, you know, come together most of the time.
So did you just follow the script, or did you research, or how did you approach?
Well, I wanted to feel, it's funny because I did like small things that didn't really matter, but to me it felt like I'm connecting to it somehow, because there's this whole blessing thing that
it's their live kids in the street.
So they have like a blessing for everything before you take a sip of the water, and when you just wake up in the morning, and before you eat, so after you go to the toilet, when you wash your hands. So I took like a few of those blessings and I studied them. I learned them by heart, and I started like doing it in my free time, and it felt really good. So it has nothing to do with the film actually, but that was like another thing that I took along with me, I guess. And well, we went to these classes of a rabbi. It's not classes, but he tells stories, and then he just like he can connect it to you. Mm-hmm. Like there are 60 people sitting in the room, but everybody feels like he's talking to me and about my personal story, and it could be completely different. Afterwards, I came with my mother or with my friend, or like we all went every week. We were supposed to come once to listen to it and to like get it, and then we just kept on going. So but we did all these preparations, like going to a wedding and to a circumcision and to meet a rabbi, and we spent a lot of Fridays in Rama's house, like with her family on Friday meals. So we did a lot, yeah.
So was your cast mixed overall, or was it a lot of Orthodox and a few outsiders, or?
No, few Orthodox and.
The other way around.
Yeah. The rabbi and the matchmaker are religious. All the other actors are secular, and the extras are from the community. So, not a lot of beards were glued to anyone's face.
Just had a strap on the seat and you were ready to go.
Yeah.
So did you? I mean, but is there a schism of any kind between, you know, actors, artists, and the religious
What's
community?
Schism?
A break, different attitudes that don't match up, but they're, you know, performing? Or is that even
because
part of the experience?
Because like religious secular, you mean?
Well, that there are people who, you know, there are things in the film that people could be critical about, or feel that the Orthodox in Israel are too, you know, too separate from the rest of the world. And some who don't. Is there a culture clash in putting together a group of people like this to perform?
I think I had conversations with people before I decided, because of that. I mean, I really tried not to control and let anyone, you know, everyone just express themselves, but I needed to feel that nobody's against it, because then it can't work. Mm-hmm. But then I took a DP that really didn't like the script. Mm-hmm. I'm like really weird with the way I casted the whole thing. But it was very interesting, and it was very fascinating to see how the Orthodox people on set became really good friends with the secular, and a lot of conversations and a lot of talks, and then you see someone that is totally secular, and then he says, but I'm doing this, 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 and this, and you say, you don't look like you're an observer, you know, like...
An objective...
You don't look like someone that really into the religion.
Mm-hmm.
It was very fascinating, and I think, in a way, it was a miracle. It could have been totally different. It could have been war, because in Israel, it is kind of war between secular and religion,
mm-hmm.
and they don't like each other. So it could have been like that, and somehow it wasn't, which was a real beautiful present for me.
And that was a big part of your casting experience, was to make sure everybody would be okay together.
No, that was the nice part. We didn't have to. It was just working out.
Huh. Okay.
I think it was, you know, whoever was connected to the script,
mm-hmm.
had something in common with something there, you know. So
the film feels very much like a documentary a lot of the time. Was that by design? Is that just the way you like to shoot, the way you like to capture images, or?
It's very interesting, because I do like magic. And I feel that feature films have more magic than documentary. For me, I'm the mm-hmm. type. I like the magic. But then again, when we worked on it, when I thought about it, I knew that you have to feel it. And in order to feel it, I have to not intrude on that. And it has to just happen. Mm-hmm. So it has that documentary feeling, because I let it happen. Because otherwise you cannot understand the film if you don't get the time to feel what's going on, because nothing's happening.
Yeah.
It's only about feelings. It's only about her heart. This is the real location of the film and what she's feeling, and how does she find the definitions to what she feels. So if you would have told me that this is the kind of film I would have done, I'm not sure I would have agreed.
Yeah,
but at the end, it was that, for example,
like, kind of film.
That it would be like a bit of a documentary. Mm. Like when we worked with music, every scene that we tried to put music in, I lost that documentary, and then I lost the feeling.
Mm.
Every intrusion was not very, it's very intimate, nothing happens, so you really have to be there to get whatever is happening, and don't intrude on that. So I really did that.
Well,
and
big
I
part
like
of that,
it at the end.
Well, big part of that feeling, I think, is that you don't force anything really onto the audience. It feels like you're in their space, just kind of breathing amongst people. And I grew up, I went to yeshiva when I was a little kid, and lived, hung out with the Orthodox. My parents did not live with them, but I was with them quite a bit. And a lot of it feels just very much like it feels in a synagogue or in that community, without feeling like anything was kind of intentionally being thrown my way.
Because the one thing I knew that I wanted to open a window, and I did not want to do more than that.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like something that is, you know, exists for 3,000 years. It's very old and ancient and very cultural and wise.
Mm-hmm.
And just let you look at it without it reflecting on the religion secular part of you, would reflect on your heart. And it was very important for me. And this is why they don't explain what they do.
Mm-hmm.
And she doesn't have a friend that she would tell her what she feels. And it's about you, you know, doing the journey,
mm-hmm.
without anyone explaining. I thought it was very important to keep it as a window.
Well, like when they were davening in the early one of the early shots in the picture, and it's 10 or so men around a table we're seeing. And one of them is deep in thought about loss, and this one, you can see that they're different places, and it's not this kind of, it's not all one, it's not all groupthink. Were you directing each one of them as to which, where they should be, where their thoughts should be, or what they should be doing, or were they kind of following the idea of the script and the scenes that were coming and what had just already happened, or?
I think the only thing I did was directing their feelings. Mm-hmm. Everyone knew exactly where he is, and then they can do whatever they want with that. I don't know how, everyone expressed it the way they wanted to express it. For me, it was important that they know what they feel. Mm-hmm. The minute they knew that, they bring whatever they want in. So everyone knew what he was feeling at that point, and everyone expressed it the way they would have expressed it, you know, so.
So a lot of takes, or any extra takes, or?
Were there a lot of takes? No, everyone was telling me I don't take enough.
Sometimes, yeah, there were, like, if you had it for the first one, then you had it.
Oh, that's
enough for me. And then Susie would say, take another one, like, just to make sure.
That was a joke.
Yeah.
For me, it was, got it. And they go, maybe you should. Okay, let's make another one. Got it.
And did you have any apprehension going into, you know, having not made a film in so long or done anything?
If I was afraid, you mean?
Yeah.
So that's very beautiful. It's a beautiful question, because I think if I would have thought that this film would really happen, then I would be really afraid. But it was me, you know, taking each step and thinking, this is it. Okay, I don't know if I'll raise the money. Then I don't know if I'll shoot it. Then I don't know if I'll finish editing it. Then I definitely don't know if someone will come see it. Then definitely didn't think that it will make the buzz it made, you know, so it was beautiful. The next film probably will not be like that. Mm. But I think that's the beauty of the first, that you don't know if it's going to really happen.
So you're not going to go back into retirement? You're ready for the next film?
I'm not sure. But if there will be.
So do you, was each experience along the way, each step, fulfilling? Is that what got you the next experience, the next part of it, or?
It just happened. You know, you walk along and okay, oh, we have money, we can make the film. Oh, there's a date for shooting. Oh, we have a cast. Oh, and I was going, oh, for like 2 years.
Well, the cast doesn't really just show up. The money doesn't just show up.
No, and it took us a year to cast the film.
So you were having a hard time with certain roles, or?
I had a hard time of understanding myself, because everyone was very talented, but I had this thing that maybe I will do a film with people and not actors. So I was auditioning a lot of non-actors, because Israel is very small. So for example, Yiftach Klein, that played Yochai, he's a star in Israel. And right before, he played a pimp and a cop and a homosexual. And now he's going to be religious, and you will believe him. Mm-hmm. So I tried to find something new.
So what was your experience with that? I mean, were you drawn to that, the idea of making the change, or were you kind of scared of that? Were you...
Of what?
Of the idea that two movies ago he played a pimp and now he's playing an Orthodox Jew.
I was not scared. I just said I wouldn't have believed him, so why would anyone else will? Yeah.
So did he convince you, or did you just change your mind?
Two things. One, he really, really wanted that part. He prayed hard, I think. And I auditioned and auditioned, and then I always got back to his audition. It was the strongest, and I felt, okay, I think when you make a love story, you have to a little bit fall in love with that person that will be that character that you actually really fell in love with. Mm-hmm. And I was looking like a man to like a little bit fall in love with him, and he was the one that had that I could see, and I said, oh, if I was in a different place, different age, different size, he would be the one, and I went with that. You know, he has it. He has something there, which is hard to find in actors for me.
Yes. And did he come before you, or were you already there?
No.
We came
you
together.
Came after.
I came after.
She came after. She was it. She was the cream of the whole thing. Because I was looking for her more than I was looking for him for that during that year. And when she walked in, it was perfect. I knew it. I just knew it. I started laughing at the audition. I started laughing like crazy because I was so excited that I found her. So.
And were you laughing at the fifth audition or the sixth audition? Or?
At the fifth audition.
Or were you just crying?
Laughing all my way to the audition.
To the bank.
No, I was really nervous. I didn't understand. I made a phone call to Michal one time, the casting director, and I don't do that kind of things, but it was like 4 weeks after the fourth audition, I think, and I called her and I was like, if it's a no, just tell me, you know, and set me free. And then she said, no, we're still looking at it. We'll, in the next 2 weeks, we'll call you back. And then the fifth one, and then finally. Yeah, so.
So as you powered through production, was it all just reflexive for you? Was it all just like a natural reflex? Did you have to intellectualize it much as you were going? Or did you just kind of know what you wanted and they gave it to you?
I think it's very good that I'm 46 years old. To do my first film. I'm at 20.
That's how I felt about having a baby.
Right? That's what, right?
That's how I felt about having a baby.
Right.
I was 45.
You're ready, and you're not into eating the world alive, and you're not into having your major career. I didn't feel those things, so I think that was very good for me. Mm. And of course, the way I live my life and chose to live my life had an impact on that. It's like everything is maneuvered, and it's not the responsibility. It's not all about you. Mm. Something's either helping or stopping it. You know, just let it be. So, I think if I was 20 and not religious, it would have been a totally different experience. So from I was floating, right? I was just going
a lot of
that.
People said that you were like the you were of course the mother of this production, but on set people felt like your energy is going through everybody, and that's why everyone was so connected, even though we were so different, but we all felt something, and that it was fun every day and no pressure, nothing.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
And how was the post experience for you?
What do you mean?
Post-production. Was it hard to edit this? Or
that was the hardest part, editing it, because then I realized that what I actually did was I directed energy and now I have to edit it, which is even more complicated than directing it, because it's like a little bit longer, a little bit, it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. Or a little bit longer is a different story. So yeah. It took us a year and 3 months to edit this film.
Because of inexperience, or because the film itself, the material was so complicated that way?
First of all, a lot of the, not a lot, but some of the crew was a first timers with me. Mm-hmm. I figured I'm doing it for the first time, let people go on that train. I thought it was good. I thought, so my editor was a first timer in feature films. She did documentary, but not feature films. So it was a process, and yet I think if she was like really did a lot of feature films before, it would have been hard because nothing is happening in this film, and like have to feel electricity and power and intensity and intimacy all the time, and how do you do it? Mm-hmm. And then my producer Saf Amir, he gives you the time, he lets you go through that process. He's really great, and he's a real artist. And he appreciates that, and he wouldn't let me leave the room without it being what it should have been, you know, because I could have left before just because I was already...
Needing a nap?
Yeah, and tearing my hair. Not taking a nap, tearing my hair.
So your editor, you stuck with your editor through whatever early bumps and trying to figure things out. You guys did it together.
Yeah.
See, in Hollywood, they just change editors every once in a while.
See, I don't believe that, because I say in everything, not only the edge, everything, you make a film, you clash to a lot of things. Mm-hmm. And I say, when I, hopefully 120 will die, then the only thing I will take with me, if I believe there's something there, is what I had with people, and not a film, and not a prize. just the relationships I had with people. Mm-hmm. So I believe in loyalty and commitment, and I feel that we can solve everything if we just stick to it. Mm-hmm. So I was the kind to stick with everything I started with this film.
So after a year and a half, you knew you had a movie?
Huh?
After a year and a half, you knew you had a movie?
I was not sure.
So how did you, what was the first step into the water of regular people?
I think the minute it was received to the Venice Festival, that was the first knock on the door saying, well, it was received to the competition. It was a first film. Usually they don't take it to competition. So we understood maybe. And then Michael Weber from Match Factory took the film. So we understood, this is how it works. And then we went to Toronto and then New York Film Festival. Everyone was like, you got to New York Film Festival. So, everything was really one step at a time. I wouldn't be able to understand it if it was at once.
So what was the experience first time in front of a regular audience? Not just friends and family.
I'm very good with people. Yet, I chose a life where I don't want to be in the front. Okay, and that's a clash because I have confidence and I'm okay with people and it's no problem with me to stand in front of people and talk or whatever. Mm-hmm. But then again, I don't want that. Mm-hmm. That was a clash. So, but I knew that if I want this film, you know, it happened, it's happening, then you have to really be there and it's your baby and you have to take care of it, so.
But I mean, was there something to remember about seeing it with an audience for that first time and
first time in Venice,
experiencing it, not just. Okay.
This is how far I am from everyone. I'm sitting at Venice Festival. This is the screening, the premiere. I'm watching it, and I have no idea why I did this film, and it's so boring that I'm going to fall asleep, and I'm just praying that they don't have tomatoes. And sure enough, the film ends and I go, just let me go with this embarrassment, and you know, and then they start clapping their hands and they don't stop with standing ovation of 10 minutes and you go, what went wrong here? Where was I? What did they see? So it's not me knowing, it's surprising all the time.
Have you gotten over this, I hope?
What? Which one?
Feeling like that they're crazy and they shouldn't be applauding, or they're gonna throw you out of the theater.
No, you don't. You go every time and you say, "This time the tomato will come." That's the day of the tomato.
And have you had any tomato fantasies yourself, or you?
Actually, I felt it too in the Venice Film Festival, but I don't know why. Maybe it was just a lot of pressure. But I remember sitting there and like I was noticing that because we watched the film already for a few times in the Academy screenings in Israel. And I remember that they didn't always laugh in those tiny moments where they used to laugh in Israel. Mm-hmm. And I felt like a different energy in the room. And I was thinking, this is the worst screening we ever had. I was really certain. And it's crazy. Maybe, I don't know what it was.
Maybe it's the connection between me and you.
Yeah, like, this is bad.
Yeah, true.
So how do you feel about the film at this point? Almost a year later, 9 months later.
It taught me something very, very strong, that being Jewish, and especially practicing Judaism, is about choosing from the moment you open your eyes till the moment you sleep and while sleeping. And this film taught me to give you as a viewer the right of choice. Okay, you can choose whatever film you want to see in this film, and not really force my vision. I made a love story. Not all people see that. Mm-hmm. And to allow that to happen and not to force it on you, that's like a lesson for life. It's not connected to cinema. It's connected to find out that you're able to do that. And I didn't think I was able to do that before.
Do you know how you did it now? can you figure out how to redo the trick?
Mm-hmm. How to let it be?
Yeah.
I think it's about growing up, you know, and not being so childish, as if you want something and then you want everyone to agree to that. Mm-hmm. It's just you want something and you do it, and then respect other people seeing it differently and loving that. I do. Mm-hmm. I went to the Q&A yesterday and this girl says to me, how could you make a film where a woman in our time doesn't have a choice? And someone's yelling, what do you mean? This whole film is about choice. And you sit like this and you say, well, kids, beautifully said. Mm-hmm. You know, this is it. It's beautiful.
You've done your job.
Yeah, I love it.
They're fighting in the aisles. You've done your work.
Yes. Yes.
And are you anxious to go start again? Or are you like chomping at the bit to, or are you excited about the prospect of, you know, diving back into the work again? Or are you kind of want a breath before you?
I think that the next project is a trap, always. I think, first of all, because what people liked in the first project was the passion of something exploding out. Mm-hmm. And I'm still touring this one to really be full with something else. So for me, it was saying to myself from the beginning, I said, this is the only project you'll ever do. Let yourself be there. Let yourself feel that. Once I did, I started writing. Oh. This is how it works if you just let go. Mm-hmm. So now I'm writing, and it's like crazy to think that something else will happen. So in a way, I feel the same. Maybe it's going to be written, really, and then maybe it's going to be produced. Wow, and this will be great. And wow.
So I think you should take the same cast and make a secular romantic comedy. Just go the other direction altogether. There's still romance, but this one would be funny.
It's always going to be romantic because I'm all about men, women, intimacy, but it's going to be different.
Well, I think that's one of the nice things about the film. I think people who don't really see orthodoxy except on the street, going to this, you know, this temple on Friday night, you know, walking around with a payas, it gives them a sense that these are real people and not just the cartoon.
So I did my work. I did my job.